Welcome to EPG Paathshala program. Myself, Meenal Katharnikar, Associate Professor in the Department of Philosophy, University of Mumbai. In this session, we are going to discuss primacy of perception and Jayarashi's critique of perception. This module is written by Dr. Dilip Mohanta, Professor of Philosophy in Calcutta University. As the title suggests to us, this module is divided into two parts. In one part, a very small part, we will be discussing primacy of perception, and then in the later, which is a major part, we will discuss Jayarashi's critique of perception. When we discuss the pramanas in Indian tradition, we are being told that there are six pramanas. So, pratyaksha, anumana, shabda, upamana, arthapatti and anupalabdhi. These six pramanas in totality are accepted in Indian tradition. It is not necessary that all the schools accept all the pramanas. So, the numbers vary as per the schools, and we have already discussed that in another module. What we can observe is that even the school which accepts only one pramana, perception has been accepted by all the systems. So, on the issue of the acceptance of the number of pramanas, we can see the primacy of perception. But primacy of perception need not be justified in this way. Ordinarily also, we experience the primacy of sense perception. May it be a realistic or any other paradigm, we know that we know the external world through sense perception. Sense perception is the only faculty which connects us directly to the world around us. Not only that, all the other faculties of knowledge, all the other sources of knowledge, or all other types of knowledge depend for their origin and validity on perception. For example, in the traditional case of Anumana, where there is inference of fire on the basis of smoke, unless the smoke is perceived, inferential cognition will not begin. So, Anumana certainly depends upon perception for the origin, though it is a logical extension or a rational expansion on the basis of other factors. What about verbal testimony? Verbal testimony is knowledge through language. But unless there is visual perception of the word, or unless there is hearing of the sound of the word, there is no beginning of Shabda Pramana. So, understanding assumes these two forms of perception. There cannot be any situation in the field of knowledge where we can talk about knowledge, but we cannot talk about perception. In that sense, in practice as well as in principle, perception is the primary form of pramana. Charvakas are the system which accept perception as the only source of knowledge. Now, it can be said that they are following the empiricist method and they have decided to accept only perceptual knowledge as the source of knowledge or as the type of knowledge. They are arguing for perception in a very rational way, but that is what is a philosophical method. So, Charvakas are hardcore empiricists in the Indian tradition. The thinker named Jayarashi Bhatta is said to be belonging to the Charvaka tradition by some scholars, but there is no unanimity of his belonging. Many other scholars regard him as the independent scholar. Now we will not go into the debate about his belonging to any particular tradition. What is very important for us is his critique of perception. Nagarjuna, Jayarashi Bhatta and Sri Harsha, these are known to be the three skeptics in Indian tradition. They are skeptics in that they have challenged the traditional ways of knowing and theorizing the concept of knowledge. Sri Harsha hails from the Vedanta tradition and he has got a critique on the Pramanas. Nagarjuna hails from the Buddhist tradition and he criticizes the well-established realistic concept of Pramanas and particularly the four Pramanas accepted by Nyaya system. Jayarashi Bhatta, as just now we said, we do not know whether he belongs to any particular tradition, but there is a ground to say that he belongs to Charvaka or Lokayata tradition because he criticizes only Pratyaksha as a source of knowledge. So the system which accepts Pratyaksha as a source of knowledge, if taken to the logical end, culminates into the skepticism like Jayarashi Bhatta. So there is a good ground for calling him a Lokayata or a skeptic from the Lokayata tradition. But again, we will keep that aside. Why could any perceptual theory lead to skepticism? If we accept only perception as the source of knowledge, then perception can give us only percepts and not concepts. With the help of percepts, we do not have any occasion or any ability to create any theory. So if we accept only perception, then we will be just talking about various sense experiences which exist in discrete forms in the world. So we have to accept them as they are existing independently of each other. If we have to build a theory, we will have to go ahead and take recourse to the reasoning. Now we all know that in Charvaka tradition, there are two camps. One are crude Charvakas and the other are sophisticated Charvakas. So sophisticated Charvakas later on accepted Anumana, which is grounded in Pratyaksha, as additional source of knowledge. Purandara is one who represents sophisticated Charvaka group. But the crude Charvakas stick to only Pratyaksha as the source of Pramana. There is high possibility that Jayarashi Bhatta belongs to this group and therefore as a logically trained person, he can see that there is no possibility of giving any theory of even perception if we accept only perception as the source of knowledge. Moreover, it is highly possible that if we just accept the discrete perceptions, then we will have only percepts without converting them into the concepts. And therefore, we will not be meaningfully able to talk about any knowledge whatsoever. So, acceptance of perception leads to the skepticism about perceptual knowledge. And that could have been the strong ground for Jayarashi Bhatta's skepticism about perception. He is described as a radical skeptic by some, because he is challenging the fundamental source of knowledge called perception. But by some thinkers, he is called as a partial skeptic because he is not considering any other sources of knowledge for his discussion. He is concentrating only on one source of knowledge. So both the descriptions of Jayarashi Bhatta, radical skeptic and partial skeptic, are possible. His text Tattvopaplava Simha is the one which gives us his arguments against various theories of perception put forward by different Indian philosophical systems. In this session, we will mainly talk about Jayarashi's criticism of Nyaya theory of perception and Jayarashi's criticism of the Buddhist theory of perception. So let us first see what is Nyaya theory of perception and then go to the main points of Jayarashi's criticism of the same. As we all know, Nyaya thinkers define perception as the cognition arising out of sense-object contact, which is without the words, which is free from the obstacles, and which is determinate. Now Jayarashi takes these features one by one and gives his criticism of the Nyaya theory of perception. The characteristics that are expounded by Nyaya Sutra have their own importance in the concept of perception. But specifically, non-erroneousness and certainness are the two features which are common to all the types of knowledge. And therefore, if the inadequacy of these two features are shown, ipso facto, all the other pramanas are also criticized and all the other characteristics are also criticized. That seems to be Jayarashi's policy while criticizing Nyaya definition of perception. Let us see the main points of Jayarashi Bhatta. He examines different possibilities. First, does it mean the cognition produced by non-defective causal factor? If it is answered in positive, then according to Jayarashi, a question arises: how the non-defectiveness of causal factors is known? It cannot be established by perception, because the senses, which are indispensable condition of perception, are beyond the scope of perception. They are so subtle that they cannot be perceived. It cannot be again established by inference, because the reason, that is hetu, the heart of inference, is beyond apprehension, and a thing which is itself not established cannot be used for establishing other things. The precise form of the argument would run as follows. Jayarashi, through analysis, has shown that non-erroneousness and definiteness of cognition is not at all possible due to the defect of anyonyashraya. So what is this anyonyashraya? Let us see the nature of that. A particular cognition is non-erroneous if it is produced by non-defective causal factors. And a causal factor is said to be non-defective if it produces non-erroneous cognition. This is a clear case of interdependence or anyonyashraya. Non-defectiveness of cognition depends upon non-defective causal factor, and non-defective causal factor depends upon non-defective or non-erroneous cognition. So, which confirms what? Does non-erroneousness of cognition confirms the non-defective causal condition, or does non-defective causal condition confirms the non-erroneousness of cognition? In the Nyaya definition of perception, these two factors are explained without properly articulating the logical relation between them. And apparently, as the definition of Nyaya suggests, there is interdependence or there is anyunyashraya fallacy committed by the Nyaya thinkers. And therefore, such definition of perception, in turn, such concept of perception cannot be acceptable according to Jayarashi Bhatta. As Jayarashi Bhatta points out, the term non-erroneousness in the sense of non-defective causal factor cannot serve as a defining feature of perceptual cognition. Let us now see other possibility. Does non-erroneousness mean a kind of cognition devoid of contradiction? Jayarashi here says that this possibility cannot be admitted because the precise meaning of this term in the context of cognition remains undefined. What is meant by a cognition being devoid of contradiction? Is it on the fact that cognition is right, or does it mean the absence of deficiency or inadequacy of causal factors operating in the production of the absence of contradiction in cognition? But there are some cases in which, in spite of the inadequacy in causal conditions, the desired cognition takes place. On the other hand, sometimes it is seen that in spite of the presence of the deficiency of the said causal conditions, the contradictory cognition is not produced. There is no contradiction when we cognize far away a mass of sun rays as water. So in the case of mirage, there is no contradiction. Moreover, there is no logical necessity that the contradicting cognition would arise immediately even when the said causal conditions for the production of it are present. It may be the case that the place is familiar to us, or it may be the case that person is standing very close to it. So even though the causal conditions in the defective form are present, the non-contradictory cognition will not take place. So what is so sacrosanct about the relation between a non-erroneous cognition and the non-contradicted cognition? This is what is pointed out by Jayarashi Bhatta. Jayarashi Bhatta here clarifies the point further. He asks, does the absence of sublation or contradiction, which makes a particular cognition non-erroneous, hold good for the reason that all people do not apprehend the contradiction, or that with reference to the different cognitions of one and the same cognizer? If the first possibility is accepted, that means if we are referring to all the people who are cognizing the object, then each and everybody would become omniscient. But this is contrary to secular loka vyavahara. We are not omniscients. We know the things with all the defects. We try to rectify our mistakes. And it is never the case that there is a possibility that we will know everything perfectly. So this loka vyavahara does not allow us to say that we are omniscient beings. We are not omniscient beings, and therefore contradictions or sublations will certainly arise even in our perceptual cognitions. Now, if we accept the second alternative, that means if we are talking about one and the same cognizer, then the non-production of contradiction depends on the cognizer's non-apprehension of contradiction among his different cognitions. If this is so, then it is justified for the simple reason that an erroneous cognition of diamond rays and of mirage and the like is cognized even when there is non-production of a contradictory cognition for the perceiver on account of his going to a different place or his death or on the similar grounds. So contradictory cognitions will take place only when the contradictory conditions are available, and that is also there is no necessary relation between the sublating conditions or contradictory conditions and contradictory or non-erroneous cognitions. So there is no necessary relation, but somehow there is a kind of causal relation in them, and in absence of certainty of these relations, this kind of definition given by the Nyaya thinkers is not acceptable according to Jairashi Bhatt. He has expounded another adverse possibility. It may be due to the nature of necessary and sufficient conditions that erroneous cognition arises in such a way that it prohibits the production of contradictory cognition. And it is due to this complex situation that a particular cognition is said to be uncontradicted, just as a cognition is recognized as valid in the cognitivist philosophy. Thus, according to Jairashi, absence of sublation or contradiction cannot serve to be proper defining characteristic of valid cognition, and thus to define valid cognition in general and perception in particular with the help of non-contradiction is not proper. Here, Jairashi Bhatt is talking about Nyaya theory of perception and the defining features of perception as expounded by the Nyaya thinkers. So his main target is the definition rather than actual cognitions. In the Buddhist tradition, perception is defined in a different way, but the idea of valid perception is also elaborated as different from the Nyaya. When Nyaya thinkers talk about non-contradiction or non-sublation, they are taking recourse to the correspondence theory of truth. According to them, if the object is grasped correctly, that perception is a true perception. But how do we know that the object is grasped correctly? It is only with the help of the correspondence between the cognition of the knower and the object itself. So there is one-to-one correspondence between the object and the cognition of the object. Buddhists do not accept this criterion. According to them, we do not have any occasion and any possibility to confirm whether the object of perception exists independently of perception. In the other module, we have seen and discussed that according to Buddhists, the object of perception is partly given and partly constructed. So, with this partly given and partly constructed object, we have no chance of deciding whether it is non-contradicted or non-sublated. But then, what is the criterion of truth of perception? According to Buddhists, the criterion of the truth of perception is artha kriya karitva. That means the ability of the perceptual cognition to lead to the successful activity. Now, Jairashi Bhatt, while criticizing the Buddhist notion of perception, makes this artha kriya karitva the main target. So let us go to Jairashi's criticism of the concept of successful activity. It is a fact of common experience that after cognizing an object, we either attempt to get it or avoid that object. If we are successful in attaining the thing, then we consider that our cognition is non-erroneous. But if we fail, then we consider our cognition as erroneous. Is successful practice the intended meaning of the term non-erroneous? The answer is in the negative. According to Jairashi, if non-erroneousness means practical efficiency, that is a connection of the said cognition with a fruit, then we must consider whether the practical efficiency is known or unknown. If it is said to be not known, then the question arises, how can we ascertain the non-erroneousness of such cognition? Here, in a particular case, practical efficiency is not known. Then for the agent of cognition, it is impossible to ascertain the truth of practical efficiency. If it is said as known, then also a question arises about successful practice as the criterion of truth. Suppose I have quenched my thirst by water. It confirms the existence of water I used beforehand. So my knowledge of water is non-erroneous here. If on the other hand, it is said that practical efficiency is something that is known, then also difficulties arise. Generally, it is admitted that the criterion of truth is successful practice. A cognition is known to be non-erroneous if practice based on the assumption of its truth results in the attainment of the desired end. If I judge the substance before me as water and subsequently wish to confirm this judgment, I may drink the substance. If I then judge that my thirst has been quenched, I am in a position to confirm the initial cognition by noting its agreement with the subsequent cognition by way of the fact that one property of water is that it quenches the thirst. But here, the skeptic Jairashi says that the previously apprehended cognition of water and later apprehended water do not belong to the same class, because the continuity may cease to exist on account of the impacts and impulses of other conditions. What Jairashi intends to say is that the exact nature of the object of practically efficient cognition cannot be described. As there is nothing that exists as class character, the said water cannot have class character. What do we understand of Jairashi's critique of various definitions and conceptions of perception? Somehow it is often objected that the refutation of all the pramanas will lead to contradiction. If we deny all theses, then we cannot deny the thesis accepting the validity of what the opponent says. And by denying the validity of perception, even makes our practical life impossible. Here the skeptic Jairashi would say that his negation of others' view is simple negation, and it is to be understood with reference to the questions they try to answer. But then what is the sum total of this skeptical enterprise of Jairashi? In the case of Nagarjuna, we have seen that Nagarjuna criticizes the very concept of pramana and pramana-prameya relationship. Jairashi is not dealing with the concept of pramana as such, but he is picking up one pramana to show that the whole business of defining pramana is futile. So he is trying to raise objections against the notions like non-contradiction, determination, or practical efficacy, and so on. So in a way, he is also expressing his unsatisfactoriness about the verbal theorization of perception. Somewhere he may not mean that the whole perception is useless, but he may argue that the attempts to define perception are useless. So this is not the denial of the fact of perception. This is the denial of the theories of perception. And with this denial of the theories, Jayarashi Bhatta is expressing his unpreparedness to accept any kind of theorization. So he may end by saying that let us keep aside all the theorization and let us experience the world as it is. So no theorization, because theorization ends into confusions and inadequate concepts. So his skepticism is more of a skepticism towards verbalization rather than the fact of perception. Now there are many reactions to Jayarashi's critique of perception. But if we want to know more about this subject, let us read the write-up that is available on this topic, and let us also read the references that are mentioned at the end of this write-up, particularly Jayarashi's text Tattvopaplavasimha is the text which refutes all the tattvas, that is all the theories. So it is worth reading from the original. The English translation of the text is also available. Thank you.